I already told him, you spent 3 days baking in the sun on that fire truck.
Hardly true.
Okay, we're ready. I'll call the meeting to order. First item would be the adoption of the agenda as presented.
Second, motion?
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
No comment from the public tonight? Now we'll move on to approval of the August 27th Park and Recreation Commission meeting. Any issues or comments with that?
Motion approved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Review of the September 10th board meeting.
No comment.
Do you want a packet?
Do you got one there?
I can print one for you in 30 seconds.
Okay.
I wasn't at that meeting anyway, so I'll leave it up to them to fill you guys in.
Anybody else? Ann, go ahead.
I'm good. I read it correctly.
I was just in the gas station. What is this?
Delicious.
Thank you.
Do I have to go with it?
Normally I haven't, but I find I should, and we have issues that we're recommending. As if either it's back or not.
Right.
So I'm going to try it.
Yeah.
It's the after.
Because I haven't really gone either.
Too bad earlier.
I know, right?
I know a couple, but not many.
Right, I mean, over the time, I have a few, but I should.
Oh, I'll just.
Make a point of.
Always expecting to show up.
Have something that we put on my show.
Yeah, no, it's true.
Well, I just got the impression that was probably going to happen, but I mustn't just wait to see this.
Sorry. That's what I wanted to do. Silence. I'm excited.
I read it previously well, but I just
reread it.
I'm so sorry for you. I know I'm in New York City, so I'm not very sorry. So I'm sure they knew what was right.
Oh, no, I thought you did. I told you it's going to be later.
Got the first block in mind.
Thanks, Eric.
Yeah, sorry. It's in fact, if anybody just shoot me a quick note when I send out the agenda, hey, please bring me a packet. I'm totally happy to print and have you ready for it.
I have a question about the board minutes that we're on. For anyone who was there, what was the public comment on the Los Colinas mini park?
So the comment about the mini park was, this is the one regarding the water fountain.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Resident complaining that the drinking fountains are clogged, or the drinking fountain at the mini park is clogged consistently, and the individual sends alerts to the rec department to address that, which gets addressed multiple times a week, and is saying something that we should look into and potentially change, replace, since it's an ongoing issue. I believe that was like the main crux of it.
And then Christine Neal came to give a presentation.
Mm-hmm. The presentation that they gave to every jurisdiction that has a fire responsibility.
Yeah.
So they gave it to Santa Fe, they gave it to the county. In fact, I actually just heard recently that today the county board approved the formation and became the first agency to join the countywide wildfire prevention JPA. Obviously, it's not to go to the voters. It needs a two-third vote because they're proposing it's going to be funded via a parcel tax. So there's more to come on that, but they're trying to gather the support of all, so they did presentations, and then they're going to do follow-up resolutions asking for these jurisdictions to formally join this JPA.
Was she asking anything of us specifically?
Isabella?
I got the impression that it was more of a temperature taking exercise than a formal commitment. I don't believe we took a vote.
No, not this time. Committing
the district one way or the other. Yeah, it was a lengthy presentation as to why the county would benefit from a joint proactive wildfire prevention effort.
Do they provide any assistance to any of our neighboring, any neighbors that are adjacent to our open space in regards to defensible space clearing?
The county?
Yeah.
They don't provide any assistance to Marinwood lands at this point.
Yeah.
No. Not specific to that initiative.
And we're not doing that, are we?
We have, yes and no. Yes, we are doing it. Yes, we have plans for it. Yes, we have policies that we've kind of mirrored the county's policies. However, we also have money allocated, and I've been working with the city of Santa Fe and their prevention staff. Of which they recently just replaced, well, both of them, as well as Quinn Gardner, who's the emergency services manager for, you know, Quinn, for the city of Santa Fe, just kind of addressing the plan and what we have looked at and decided is the priority, given the amount of resource we have for it right now, is really that kind of buffer zone around some of the more vulnerable areas that directly interface residential housing,
right.
You know, the woolies,
yeah.
With that, and looking at those 100-yard, 100-foot
defensible
yeah. space clearings. The other thing that I am working on with Centerville is, and I actually put this in my manager report for the board meeting, is working on a grant application to bring in AmeriCorps. And a team of like 8 to 12 to physically go out and do that work. It would be a very minimal cost to the district, basically tools, supplies, things along that. Santa Fe would be a joint applicant. They would actually stay at the old fire station 53 on Joseph Court, just over there. Santa Fe had a team last summer that ended in about mid-July. That's where they stayed. They said it worked out really well, and we're looking at trying to help us get that same resource to get them to come out, and they would be able to do, oh, well, let's just say it would take our funds and stretch them exponentially in terms of how much work could actually get done to do all that, because we don't have the personnel to do that kind of work. We'd be spending our money contracting labor to do it, as opposed to bringing in this on an AmeriCorps grant, which would be really cool. And Quinn Gardner, who is the one I've been working with, is actually a former AmeriCorps. So she has a lot of knowledge and connection in it as well.
That was also a record.
Well, there you go.
At one point. I'm sorry, maybe I missed it. Do we have like a written plan that can be reviewed by the public on in regards to where, like how much, how many acres we're clearing?
We have a policy.
But are there maps and whatnot where somebody could review that information?
In terms of what I was just talking about?
Yeah.
No, it hasn't been solidified. So it's not a finalized thing.
We're working towards that.
Yes. And then we're looking at it and saying, okay, we have $40,000 set aside for vegetation management specific to those. Mm-hmm. How much can we get done? Where's the priority areas? And we're, again, looking at the woolies. But in looking at that, it's also identifying what areas are not property that the district owns.
Mm-hmm.
So like there's areas, say, you know, kind of out by Heatherstone, up on top of the hill over there,
it's HOA.
Yeah. It's also MMWD.
Yeah.
There's an HOA. Regency has weird pockets.
Yeah.
All of the area on the other side of Las Colinas here, like Olvia Court and everything, is all owned, private owned by what's called the Daphne Trust. So literally, the district cannot go out and start doing
sure.
work on those properties. So it's, you know, identifying, each one of those that isn't ours, and then looking at it, the main areas we've been looking at, and again, this is incredibly preliminary, is kind of from Idleberry, starting kind of where it breaks to go to the kind of county farm area, working all the way down and around along Miller Creek, and focusing on that area right now as kind of the prime threat area that is most vulnerable.
Is there a target date to finalize that plan?
It kind of fell when they lost all of their hedge management people who they've just brought back on. So we're getting it back up and going. Taking advantage of their expertise in planning it out and looking at it. And that's all part of our contract with them for chief officer and administrative services.
So once that's finalized, that will come to this commission then for us to review?
Yeah, and the fire commission
right.
and everything else. And then ideally we'll have more information too on if can we bring in the AmeriCorps to really do the work and get it all done. In the meantime, we continue to promote what our current policy is, which is that you know private homeowners can do vegetation management 100 feet into the open space without need for a permit, that we are welcome to come out, they're welcome to ask for an assessment from the fire department in terms of what should be cleared, how should it be cleared, limbing up, doing work like that.
Thank you.
Yep. And they and I will say the fire department has also gone around and done a lot of private residential veg management inspections on request too. And they've been obviously getting more of those in the this year especially. And they'll go out and do an assessment, you know, just kind of a eyeball test and say, yep, you got some ladder fuels here. These are flammable plants there. This is this. I would recommend doing all this. And they've done quite a few of those.
And they've been using the volunteer firefighters, I believe, to do that, right? And the CFL crew as well.
Yeah, the volunteer and AmeriCorps actually went and didn't go by specific request, went through and did kind of a blanket survey and driving the streets and looking at areas. When we get calls in, our on-duty guys do it in between calls when they have time and they go out and have quite a bit more training and understanding on that than our other volunteers. Otis Smith, Brian Smith, has kind of been leading that charge. He is our prevention officer, and he's been the one who's been trying to do it during his duty days when they're not on call or don't have something else going on. They go out and do the inspections and actually do a really nice write-up about it and send it to the homeowner and copy me and the chief in on it.
I think my primary concern with the presentation and the effort altogether is that it really doesn't address the frontline issue, which is money for the work being done, because that will create another layer of bureaucracy that I can see how that is needed to coordinate the efforts and to educate everyone and bring everybody on the same page. However, it does not fund the actual work, or it funds it to a limited
Really? The $21 million a year that they're talking about getting out of this parcel tax?
Yeah, that's why I was asking if the county was going to help in this endeavor.
So my understanding was that we would get a fraction of the funds that we would be paying into it. Was I mistaken?
I don't know. I'm not correcting you. My understanding was ideally, that a lot of these funds were to do the veg management work, were as well as the administrative, as well as some of the other preventive. And then looking at some of the things that were addressed in the grand jury report, like the evacuation routes and things like that.
Yeah,
too.
I mean, I saw this being primarily applicable to areas like Mill Valley or Sausalito, where you have one lane road that's overgrown and obstructed, and that's, you know, that's obviously an issue, which is not necessarily that applicable in our area.
Right. Well, and that's the part that'll be interesting is, to your point, and I think there is some confusion, and maybe I'm just still a little too ignorant on it, in that, so the county jumped on, but they don't have a formal written up of what this JPA is. They have this has got to go into an ordinance that's going to go onto the ballot, and that, I don't believe, has even happened yet.
Right.
Which is like
there have been studies made to kind of take the temperature on what the voters would approve, whether it would be parcel tax versus sales tax, etc.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I think the expectation is that it is going to be on the November ballot.
March.
March ballot.
Yeah, March. Yeah, that's the expectation as far as I know it right now, too. So I guess to your point, it would be concerning if a large portion of that funding that they're done, because they're talking $21 million a year that this thing would bring in countywide, if that's not earmarked in a large portion to do the vegetation management work, would be concerning. You know, what is it for? I don't know. I need to educate myself a little further on it. I just don't think that they've formally drawn that up yet.
Yeah.
Is my point. Maybe what they presented to the Board of Supervisors at their meeting today, where the Board of Supervisors approved it, had more. I haven't had a chance to look at their packet yet, so I don't know. And I haven't received anything directly for it yet. And unfortunately, I wasn't at the meeting, but this presentation was like an hour plus. So I would certainly defer to whatever Isabella took from it.
No, I mean, to hold my attention for over an hour.
Sorry to sidetrack us. I'm just curious about that. I don't feel like on the Park Commission we've really ever talked about defensible space.
Right.
That when a plan does get finalized, I would be curious to review it.
Sure. Yeah, sure. No, and to your point, I mean, I guess even in my own mind, I've always looked at this as more of a fire prevention fireside, and it goes into our open space.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, how the work done, and it's can be, there's a lot of details there, so.
Yeah, have they come to the open space district with this at all?
The fire department? The county fire.
The
county Parks and Open Space Commission has heard reports from our staff on veg management and wildfire prevention. I don't know if the fire department has presented to them. I would think yes.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
I know that they went around and put up all 19 current agencies that have fire protection responsibility, but it would seem that they'd also be hitting up the agencies, and usually they're one and the same. So I guess since the county board of supervisors ultimately is the board of
the... Right. We have staff at Marin County Parks that specifically spend their entire job is focused on this. They present to the Parks and Open Space Commission almost every session.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it's an important issue, obviously.
Yeah, and I just don't know what levels of collaboration. That was my question. What levels of collaboration are happening there, I wonder.
Yeah.
I don't know. And hopefully...
Between the County Fire Department and Marin County Parks?
Well, this larger initiative.
I'm not.
Right.
I get it.
All right. Yeah, sorry, I wish I'd give you more. I'll see if I can get some more info from Chief Gray on it, too, because he's been pretty plugged in, obviously, on this at the county.
I'm sure this presentation is available.
Yeah. If it was at the commission today, you can view it online right now.
Yeah, well, and you can go and watch what they presented here.
Yeah.
You're not going to be able to see the slideshow quite so great, but I can get you a copy of the slideshow. But you'll be able to hear all.
I've seen Christy's presentation. Okay. She's done it. She does it all the time.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So,
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
Okay. We'll move on to item number 5, which is the potential revisions of the community center rental policies. Both reviewed the document that we've submitted. I guess opinions or ideas from?
I don't know. Is there more that you were going to share with us before we got into it, or?
Hit some of the just main points of what sort of went into this memo. It's mostly laid out there, but the recreation department has just been, for the last year plus, looking at the private rental situation in the community center, and just seeing sort of an increase in just the parties and that have caused some of these issues that I laid out with wear and tear on the building and the grounds. Some challenges with staffing and a handful of times when law enforcement's had to come out, some issues we just really don't want to see you know, here in our community center and things we didn't see as much in the past. And so trying to figure out some ways to cut down on that and how to approach these rentals moving forward. You know, I kind of inherited this system, taking over the director position, and just seeing how this goes. It's like, this doesn't seem like things are moving in the right direction. And then there was the incident in April, you know, where an individual was arrested and on some serious charges, and that really, we'd already been having this conversation at the staff level about what should we be doing with these rentals, and they're just starting to, you know, more and more kind of problematic things happening. So that happened, and we really just sort of decided we really need to focus on possibly revisiting this policy and making some changes. It's something that we're not sure exactly what direction to move in. I have my recommendation, which I laid out here. There's a lot of things we can do. We did a lot of research looking at some of the other facilities that are rented out by government agencies like us, so some of the other community centers, some of the other private rental spaces in Marin and elsewhere, to see where we fit in. And we made some changes to our policy already earlier in the year, which are laid out some of the bullet points here on page one. In terms of our capacity, the hours, the how we deal with security deposits, and just training staff that are here. But I think there's some bigger questions that I would like to see discussed in terms of the overall philosophy of what's the community center for, how should we deal with renting it out to the public and or to private individuals for private events. Do we need to be doing that? Is that an important service that we're offering? And if so, who should that be? Should this be anyone and everyone that wants to do that? Or should there be, should this be something that we limit to residents only? And I, in my opinion, if we limited rental of the community center to Marinwood residents, we would be able to cut down on a lot of the negative elements that have been happening in private rentals without having to limit what the residents can do at these events. So some of the things are listed in here, top of page two of the memo. You know, we could cut alcohol, we could add a security requirement, we could limit, you know, hours even more, limit capacity, and all those things are things that would probably help some of these problems. I just feel like the resident rentals that we have, we really don't have many issues, and things usually go very smoothly, and I think it would be a shame to impose some of these restrictions on our neighbors and residents that don't really cause the problems. And it seems like if we limited to residents, we would remove the problems without having to limit what our residents are able to do with their community center. So that was my feeling. I think that'd be the easiest way forward. But that's definitely something that I think, you know, this is a little bit, would be worthy of discussing at this level and the board level potentially. So, that helps lay out a little bit.
So, Luke, it's my impression that the revenue that you generate from these activities doesn't really keep up with the cost of maintaining the infrastructure. You stated that you're refinishing floors and five times more frequently than you used to, or whatever. Is that enough money that it benefits the district, or is it just kind of a break-even thing? Or it sounds to me like it's costing money to do it.
Well, it's hard to say exactly, because it's not like the funds that come in from the building rentals gets put in a category specifically to do improvements or maintenance or cleanup. It's just those projects come up and funds get allocated accordingly in the budget. The floor that we have, and it lasted 30 years, and then we replaced it about 5 years ago. Demolished it and had a new floor put in. And now we've completed our final sanding job this summer, and the next time the floor is worn out, it will need something else will need to be put in. Hopefully we get another 5 to 10 years out of the current floor if we take, you know, really good care of it. But that's just one instance where I think the increase in large parties has had an impact. Obviously, we have big programs. We have a big summer camp that's on the floor. We've got dance classes. There's a lot of things that contribute to the wear and tear on the community center. But that's been, you know, this is one area that seems to have been ramping up in the last 10 years. And our, so that's one specific thing. As far as how the funds or the revenue goes against the expenses of keeping the community center up, that's hard to measure because there's so many things using the building. I couldn't say exactly what the numbers are for that. We could dive in and try to really suss that out, but at this time I couldn't say exactly.
And then even with your kind of the handful of measures over the past year, I still see a difficulty in ensuring compliance with some of these. I mean, unless you're standing there with a badge and a gun, you know, how do you make people vacate the premises without getting in their face about it? I mean, you know, if people are courteous, then there aren't really issues. But, you know, it seems like enforcement of some of these things is probably well beyond the job description of your staff.
Yeah, it is challenging, and a lot of what tends to happen when the renters are not being respectful of the curfew and not taking the proper steps. You know, they get told many times, it's time to stop, it's time to turn off the music, it's time to clear out. You know, that most rentals, they are pretty good and help out, but then, you know, there's the occasions where they ask for extra time, which we don't allow, you know, on day of, time of, and they will just, you know, the building attendant is forced to just strongly encourage and say, if you go over the time, you're going to be penalized via your security deposit. And people sometimes just go late, and then our staff have to just sort of wait it out and do their best to encourage them to clean up. So you could have security here trying to enforce that. You could call law enforcement to try. It's just, you know, it's one of those things that it's an ongoing challenge for staff to try to enforce these things, like you said.
And I see the same thing with the capacity. I mean, how is staff going to control, you know, people walking in the door? It's like they don't have that authority to, or, you know, they shouldn't be expected to. You know, no more in here. You turn people away. That's a difficult job for someone to try to, you know, of your staff to try to...
Right, and that's actually a really good point, John, because historically how we've done the rentals here going way back is they've been smaller, they've been, you know, a lot of small resident, you know, retirement parties and different, I mean, a whole gamut of different things, tended to just go very smoothly, and we've got someone here just in case the power goes out, or in case there's an emergency, they can, you know, kind of alert, let's see what's going on, and they might call me and say, hey, we can't get this one outlet to work. Is there, you know, with a breaker box? You know, just things like that. But as far as having to deal with violation of policy and cleanup not taking place and some unsavory elements coming in, that's definitely changed the nature of what our building attendant is having to deal with. And if we, to really be able to get a better control over some of these issues, we really need to staff the events differently and have more of a, I think, more of a presence, have more of an on-site coordinator, have a little bit more control over these things. And I think, you know, we don't have the staff for that. We'd have to jack the prices way up and hire people to come in and sort of run these events. And that's just a whole different ball game from what we've been doing with private building rentals. These things have been like the occasional Saturday. We've got someone, you know, hanging out. But the way the events have been going to really curb some of this, without making a major policy change, I think we really have to have a much bigger staff presence and be more of an on-site, you know, we're here coordinating these things, which we don't have the staff to do that currently.
What percentage do you think of the events are residents and non-residents?
Right now, it's pretty 50-50. Like the last week, we were looking through like the last few years. It's pretty even.
It's much more than I thought.
Much more of which?
I thought it would be more local, more resident.
And yeah, I think, and you know, partly maybe the way we have it set up, our current requirement is an 8-hour block minimum, and I think you know, I don't know if that length of time and the cost that's in is, you know, it might deter some of the residents from some of those events that they might have, that we would be a 4-hour smaller type thing. They're sort of been going elsewhere for that because we're our minimums are a much larger span. So I'm not sure that's it's a good thing, like, you know, something we're definitely considering as well.
Interesting that these residents, limited to residents, but offer a 4-hour block.
Mm-hmm.
You might get more use of the facility for things like a birthday party, indoor birthday parties in the winter,
that's
and
great.
Things like that.
Mm-hmm.
You could see a lot
that's
of things.
Yeah, and that's been some of the...
Make sure the facility's really bringing in that revenue, but with a smaller resident.
It's a great suggestion, I think, because for, let's say, a child's birthday party, spending $600 might be a little bit too pricey, even for Marin tastes, versus, you know, if the price was lower and it was only like let's say a 3 or 4 hour block, we might be able to split the Saturday into two events. But in my opinion, there are two components to this issue. One is the policy/philosophical one, and then the other one is the financial. And I think to understand the financials, we not only need to understand how many residents versus non-residents are renting, but also my understanding is that there are different rates for residents versus non-residents. So even though the split is 50-50, it might be very well that 3/4 of our rental revenue comes from non-residents. So that would be an important thing to look at in terms of money coming in. In addition to the revenue, we also have to look at the expenditures always, right? So not only when it comes to this particular issue, but also other programs that we have running, it's good to have an understanding of the revenue versus expense. How much this is the program bringing in, how much does it cost us to run this program, which does not necessarily mean that we have to eliminate that program, such as Music in the Park. We know it's not our bread and butter. However, it's a hugely popular community building event and nobody would dream of canceling it. Now, I would strongly recommend having the numbers for the board meeting, for example, because the same way you are posing the questions, the board will be posing the questions. What is the money coming in? How much are we spending on it? We have to pay the building attendant, we have to, you know, fix the chairs, we have to fix the tables, we have to polish the floor. These are all the components that could go into the financial analysis. Now, aside from that is the philosophical and the policy issue, in my opinion, which is, I didn't even think of this, but I love your idea of limiting the rentals to residents only. After all, it is a community services district, it's a community center, and I'm not sure if it's 100% legal. I think Eric is looking into that. However, if we are not able to preclude non-residents from renting the facility, we might be able to implement a fee structure in such a way that it really does the policy for us without us having to have the policy. You know what I mean? You know, the breakdown of a Saturday into 2 4-hour blocks, keeping the rental fee lower for the residents versus really increasing the fee for non-residents, because we know that this is the majority of our problem scenarios. That could be an option. Also, I would be strongly in favor of making sure that the contract is laid out in such a way that people, you know, regardless what your capacity for English is, for example, myself being an ESL, I want to make sure that everybody understands that guns are not permitted here. That you do have to vacate the premises once your time is up. There's like no restrictions. And so I think we need to make sure that these safety mechanisms are there, that are clearly visible for all people who rent. That would be definitely within our capacity to, whether through policy or through financial, through fee schedule, regulate the rental. Sorry for this monologue.
I have one thing to the financials of the few. Do you bring financials to the board? It might be worth it to just add on a hypothetical scenario. If you decide you want to look into renting in smaller blocks and having residents only, like how many more bookings you think you might get as a result of that. So you have your baseline scenario with all the revenue coming in, and you have one where it's residents only, and then you have one where you've made some policy changes. It's still residents only, but there's some measures taken to encourage bookings.
Yeah, we have sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, we have all of the numbers and all of this information at hand, and it's so you know that the reason and for as far as if the goal is to keep everything status quo in terms of policy, we have many things that we are ready to implement to you know limit some of the negative elements here in ways we can amend sort of what we're doing in the details of how we facilitate these rentals. The reason we're bringing this to the commission and then eventually the board is for the bigger question, is this something we want to do? Is this community center something we want to rent out to the general public, or do we want to limit this to residents? And I think that's the big question, because the answer to that will then determine how we proceed with the policy, with the way we have the rental contract written out, with what the requirements, the hours, all of that is going to be dictated by how we answer that question. And on the staff level, we've come up with a whole range of scenarios and different things that we will do depending on sort of what the answer is to that question. So that's sort of the philosophical is what we're looking for guidance on when it comes down to what sort of is determined. Then we kind of we take that ball and run with it. We've got kind of MBPC. So that we're definitely ready to go on that as soon as we sort of everyone's able to weigh in and see what everyone wants to do. As far as the financials, we definitely can say this is how much revenue is brought in by the non-resident rentals. This is how much is brought in by the resident rentals. It's not clear that changing this policy would result in just the resident revenue we brought in from this year or last year, because a lot of the non-resident rentals are booked farther out in advance, so a year out versus sometimes some of the rentals will come and book 2 weeks out and there won't be anything available. So it's hard to know what that's going to look like. If we were just renting to residents, we may see a lot more resident rentals just because people may not be planning as big of events and taking the year to do a big wedding reception or something like that. So that's sort of an unknown that we wouldn't really be able to predict until we see how it plays out that first year or something. But I do fully agree that we can look at that and this philosophical question may or may not be hinged on the finances. I'm not sure how I'm interested to see what everyone thinks about that. It's like, yes, we think this is really important, but it's going to cut into the revenue too much. Let's not do it. I that's just an interesting those two things to weigh. But definitely have all of that available, for the board meeting at the break. So.
I think if we're here to discuss this and talk about that philosophical question in my mind, I can't really separate that out from the fiscal impact. I don't know how any of us could. I don't have a sense whether that's a 50% reduction in operating costs or a 2% reduction. I have no idea.
Well, just to give you just the bare, you say the rentals are fairly even in terms of resident, non-resident.
Right.
The price difference is about double for the non-resident rental rate. So non-residents being charged $1,000 versus like $550 or $1,200 versus $600. That's what we're looking at. So $1,200 for a non-resident rental, 8-hour block, versus $600 for a resident rental. So that's basically we're looking at the rentals bringing in. Eric,
it'd be a third, two thirds.
Yeah,
So because it's half the cost, a third of the total revenue would be from the residential, while 2/3 of the total revenue, even though they're half of the.
I understand all that, but what's the percentage of the revenue generated over the year? I don't know. This needs to be put in the context of the whole.
It brings gross revenue on rentals. Say that this last year was about $48,000.
And so, what percentage of that is that of the revenue that we generate for the year?
Well, we only fee service revenue?
Like, if it's negligible, if we're talking this is a nominal number, then fine, I understand that. But if it's
our total revenue is over $6 million.
So this is peanuts, is what you're saying.
Well, but this let's just keep in mind that the $6 million revenue deal of probably 50%, if not more, I'm sorry, I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, are taxes. So it's non-fee revenue. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, you have to also further subtract the humongous operation of summer camps out of this, because that's $250,000 in profit, pure profit.
Right.
So... I'm sorry, we should not be talking about profit and
I just want to, you know what I mean. It feels like ill-informed. For me, I don't feel informed. Like, if you're saying it's a negligible dollar amount, then that's good to know. But if it's not a negligible dollar amount, then I would want to know that, and that would influence my thoughts on it. But, so do we...
I think when you look at it in that perspective, then yes, you can consider it a negligible dollar amount. I think when you look at it in the big picture as to can this district afford to call any revenue a negligible dollar amount, then my answer changes. Because I don't think that we're in such a broad fiscal position that anything is negligible per se.
Right.
I mean, it all certainly helps. We don't have large coffers that we're sitting on in the back.
But it might, when you present this to the board, it might be nice to show this as a percent of the overall operating budget. And like, where is this? Is it 0.5%? I mean, I think it would just help the conversation. I had a couple other comments, which was, do we think, it sounds like what you said is you're not sure if this would create more opportunities for Marinewood residents. It may or may not.
The feeling on our level is that we would likely see an increase in resident use of the community center just because of the more availability. That's so I don't know, I don't expect us to have the same frequency. I don't think every weekend would be booked at all, but I do think that we would see an increase in resident use while we would see an overall decrease in the number of rentals that are going on,
right.
Which have been ramping up, you know, steadily in the last decade. So
I feel a little ignorant to ask this question, but in our mission statement, does it explicitly say to serve residents at Marinewood? Do we know that?
Jeez, I just looked at the mission statement and I promptly... I will look it up.
Okay. I think it would be important that if this was a policy shift, that it still remain consistent to the mission statement. And then I'd be curious, what do other CSDs do locally? Do they have this problem? What are they limiting it to local residents only? I totally sympathize what you're saying, and it sounds absurd, some of the things going on. Same time, I can't help to feel in the back of my head that what is this, a private country club? You know, that like we're being exclusive.
Well,
and I don't want to my brain to go there, but I think, you know, Eric, you looking into the legality of it, if it's even legal to do this.
We've already started that.
Yeah, I think that's important to do. I would not want to be in the newspaper,
right,
being
right. Exclusive.
Like, that's all the Dixie neighborhood needs on top of everything else.
Right.
However, having said that, what you pointed out, when you pointed out to the mission, our mission does specifically say that we provide various services to the residents of the district. So provide fire protection and emergency services to the residents of the district, to provide street lighting services to the residents of the district, to develop and promote recreation programs and activities which satisfy the majority demands of the residents of the district, and develop, maintain park areas and recreation facilities, preserve open space for the enjoyment of the residents.
Great, that's good.
But that said, the counter to that is all of our programs are open to everybody. We get a large number of non-residents in the summer camps. We get a large number of non-residents at the pool. We get a large, you know, I mean, so it's, there's an easy counter to that, too, because how it's like, okay, well, our mission says we're going to serve residents, yet in practice, we serve a much broader community.
And I think that has been increasing. The percentage of non-resident participants in our program has been increasing over the last decade or so, mainly because of the appeal of the extra revenue our district gets. I mean, we could very easily scale back the summer camps or limit the pool use only to the residents, but that will make sustaining the pool operations impossible.
And
we would be losing, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars in revenue on camps. So, as always, it's not a black and white thing.
There's something about the exclusivity that doesn't sit well with me. I've rented spaces in Fairfax. I don't live in Fairfax. Like, that doesn't seem to be an issue anywhere else. I don't know. It's, if there was a way we could continue to serve the neighboring communities as well, but do it in a way that was that work for us. I would prefer that as an option, but I totally hear your challenges.
Another walk around this residency thing is you could look for, you know, a resident who would sponsor your event if you're a non-resident. This way we at least have this link, you know, with the community, because it seems like historically people who live here and interface with the staff throughout the year treat the staff and the property with due respect, versus, you know, people who may not have the vested interest and are just, you know, one night by buyers, you know.
I think there's a lot to what Isabella said in terms of, you know, a lot of this growth happened as opportunities to increase revenue, and a lot of it was focused during the time when the district had a lot of revenue problems, the last economic downturn, you know, and staff were getting laid off, downsized. We were operating in the red for an entire fiscal year where, you know, more went out than came in. And the rec department at the time did find a lot of ways to bring in other revenue, being, you know, through increasing the camps, more aggressively marketing the rental of the community center, things along those. I asked the same question shortly after I started of, you know, why the 8-hour versus shorter blocks, and my understanding at the time, which I do understand, was there was a revenue generator, and B, there was no issue filling 8-hour blocks. They were being filled regularly, but if you book a 4-hour, it was a lot harder to book another 4-hour to fill the remainder of the day. So even though you could do shorter events, it's hard to time those out and to book multiple shorter events in the period of the same day, which I get, which makes logical sense to me, and it is harder. So you lose out on some of those opportunities to generate more revenue, which was a bit of a goal of a lot of this growth at the time, that there was no problems filling up full days with a single rental. But challenges filling up a full day with multiple rentals.
We could solve it, though, probably by, you know, maybe allocating, you know, let's say 2 weekends for split Saturdays and 2 weekends for full Saturdays, you know, do something like that, depending on the need. If there is a larger need for 8-hour rental, keep 3 Saturdays for... I mean, this is just a technicality.
Yeah.
I think at the end of the day, we're coming back to...
But I think when people come looking to rent the space, they have a specific date already in mind, and they're not saying, okay, we'll do it on this weekend, then I can do a 4-hour rental. You know, it's to mark a significant event, and it is on that date. There are some that are a little bit more generic, but most of the things that come in terms of private facility rentals are for a very, you know, there. We get calls about, is this date available? As opposed to, what dates are available? Probably 5-1. And we try to push. When somebody says, you know, is this date available? We say no, but this date is. that they won't work. So, you know, and Luke would have a better handle on Carolyn, especially would have a better handle because she's the one who interfaces with those calls. I don't deal with any of that because I'll just mess something up in the computer system and they don't want me touching it.
We could separate that. And if the decision is made to do residents only, then just see if the calendar doesn't fill, then you have some thoughts. Of,
sure.
We can look at that later.
Just to gauge the commission's feeling about this, I sense that there is a need for more information to make an educated decision. You would all, I don't know, I get it from John Campbell to get the, am I correct to understand that you would want to see this part of the equation as well, or would you be ready to voice your recommendation to the board at this point?
No, I think more information is required. I tend to follow Luke's recommendation in the end that if we could make it for a community event, I mean, you know, members of the community, but even then, when you start thinking of school children or, you know, something like that from outside the area, it's, you know, I don't think I want to be turning events like that away. So I definitely think we need a better understanding. Having those fiscal numbers, you know, I think help. And the other issue is if we do change things and it, say it did become a residence only, then there's going to be a time lag through that before you kind of can really pull accurate numbers because it's been like this for so long that, oh, I didn't know that's what we do now. So
and things, you know, are booked ahead probably for next year, right?
Right. So
no, not as much right now because we've stopped taking events with the exception of things that are kind of more on the annual events, like X group books the hall for a crab feed every year. So we haven't stopped those. But we've been talking about this, as Luke said, for quite a while, and when this other incident happened, we said, okay, action is needed now. We do have some still, but we've cycled through a lot of those because this was, you know, kind of back in April we just did. We're going to stop taking future events until we fill this, figure this out more, with the knowledge that there's like a handful of spots available for the next 6 to 8 months with some more things filled. To your point, it would take, in theory, a year from that April to really say, okay, now what is the impact from this point moving forward, where the only events are events that have happened since we've done this change, assuming you do this change. But my understanding, and Luke, please shoot me down if I'm wrong, is we've managed to fill, we've gotten to a point now where there are some open gaps in the schedule, kind of in the foreseeable future for rentals.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
I just want to say one thing briefly. Just to bring it back to the big question, For the staff, what I would say is sort of going on here, and what really came to a head with the event that happened in April is the nature of Marinwood's private rental situation has changed, and we need to catch up to it. And one thing that my recommendation here, limiting to residents, you know, one way to go. Will allow us to kind of move forward without making major changes to how we approach rentals, in my opinion, and based on what we've seen in evaluating the kinds of rentals that have been taking place. Absent that change, I think no matter what, you know, there's all sorts of different ways we can do hours and schedules and fees, and we have a lot of information and a lot of plans to do that. I'm not looking necessarily for the exact rental policy, you know, here today that we move forward with. It's more, if we're going to continue things where we're open to the general public, then the way that the recreation staff is going to have to approach rentals is going to need to change in terms of our staffing, in terms of how much time commitment is going to go into these. If we're requiring security, we're going to be interfacing with security companies, we're going to have a higher level of training with the building attendants, we're going to be interfacing with the renters in a more, it's going to be a more time-consuming meeting and going over things and walking tour. There's just going to be a lot of things that's going to change what we need to do as a staff to ensure that these rentals go smoothly. If we're going to continue to operate the way we've been operating, open to the general public, I believe. So the proposal at hand, I think, is one way that we could avoid adding all of that to our rental program. But absent making that change, which I totally understand both sides of it, we would definitely, this is going to be a much bigger time commitment and staff commitment to continue moving forward with renting out the community center. In order to ensure that we do not have major incidents taking place, law enforcement coming out and, you know, people brandishing weapons and whatnot at the community center. So the nature of rentals has changed, and this is one way to address it. Absent that, we're definitely going to be, you know, taking a lot of other measures. That's why that question is at hand. And as far as the details of how we approach hours and prices and everything, that's something that definitely can come down the pike.
But it does seem that we're kind of on the borderline of this safety issue, not only for staff but community as well. If there are events where, you know, the issue you had in April, or there are people under the influence of drugs or alcohol, they become combative, or, you know, if I'm just strolling through the neighborhood at night and my, you know, it seems like things are starting to get to the point where we need to put some kind of a rein on it and just, you know.
Well, it's like, is that what this community center is for? And I think that's a question I asked him here, is this an important part of our program, to have a space where people can have a big wild party, not wild, it's going to be wild, but just, is that an important thing? And it may very well be, but I'd be curious to hear weigh in from everyone. Is that an important part of our charter, and is that, and some of these elements that are coming with having big parties in our community center, is that something that we're comfortable bringing into the neighborhood and into our community center? I'd be curious.
So I think you made your case very clearly, and I think we all hear you, and I don't think anyone disagrees with you at all. Like, I think that we, I think that we are open to your suggestions, and we value your input because you are the, you know, front and center at this issue. I get the sense that, you know, to make such an important policy decision, the commission also wants to examine the financial impact of it, and I think that's more to understand, to kind of see the complete picture. And I would venture to say that you would be willing to make a clear recommendation to the board at your next commission meeting when you have all the information in place. Am I correct to assume so?
I believe you.
I would like to see it. I mean,
right.
I would like to see the information.
You will recommend
it
one way or the other. You will recommend something to the board, whether it's, you know, yes or no. But to make some kind of recommendation, you would like to see the financial data, correct?
I had some other questions. I mean, I think this is a big decision. Did you have something? I don't. So, to answer your first question, I don't know, because I don't know what we're going to get next month. We might say we want more information, so I don't know. But it's not, to me, it's not only financial information.
No.
It's more than that. And this, your summary is anecdotal, which I appreciate. But can you give me a sense of, like, what percent of events has there been problems at? Like, I don't know if it's...
Oh, it's definitely small. I mean, it's a very small percentage. I'd say the community center is rented at least once a weekend almost the entire year. We have maybe three or four events a year where we have an issue, like whether it's a major noise complaint or the sheriff is called for an issue that needs to be dealt with. Maybe three, I'd say, events out of the entire
out of the year
that we're dealing with that. So it's not a large percentage at all.
It's rented Friday and Saturday.
Sometimes Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Sometimes just a Saturday. So
like 150. So three out of 150 events a year.
Yeah, something that's probably a fairly accurate percentage. Yeah,
it's pretty low.
It's low. However, it only takes one. You know, at that. And again, I'm not. This is just one idea, but it's. Yeah, I'm not trying to paint the picture. That we've got, you know, the cops here every weekend. Not at all. It's just, but the question is, at one event, you know, when something happens, like what happened in April, that's where we're saying, well, what are we doing here, and do we need to revisit this? That's that sort of the work.
I mean, but that said, a resident only policy wouldn't necessarily prevent somebody pulling out a sidearm. I mean, it still could happen, so that doesn't address that head on.
No, absolutely. No, it doesn't.
And you could still get noise complaints. I think that's an important number also to bring to the board. If it truly is three out of 150 events, that's not that significant. And then who would be impacted by this most? Who do you suspect, like, if we did limit this to residents only, who might not be able to rent a space? I don't know how you say this word. You said you including multiple quinceañeras. Quinceañeras. Like, are those events from neighborhoods that maybe don't have a community center that rely on this space to have those events? Would those be limited because of this policy?
I couldn't speak to that. I have no idea of all the events we have that are rented by non-residents. I imagine we are not the only option for any of the non-residents renting our building. There's a lot of rentable spaces in the area in Marin, but there's no way of knowing that if they didn't have our building to rent, that they would be out of luck. There's just no way of knowing that.
I think, and finally, I would also be curious, have you reached out to other CSDs or community centers to ask them about this situation? Have they had this situation? Like, how often does it happen with them? Like, what are their mitigation measures to prevent this type of thing?
Yes, we have. We've reached out to a lot of our fellow community centers in Marin and our colleagues, and there are a whole range of different approaches that the other places have. Some do require security at their events, licensed security for events over a certain attendance number, or events that have alcohol, or events where the honoree is under the age of 21 or something like that. So there's designations like that where that's built into their policy. But yeah, there's a lot of things like that. Some places have that requirement, some places do not. But our concerns with things outlined here are not unique to us, and it's a challenge with a lot of the other community centers, and these discussions are happening elsewhere as well. So
have you encountered any other community center that has taken this policy position where it's residents only?
I believe the only other place nearby that has a residents-only policy on facility usage is Belmarine Keys, and possibly Strawberry, but their policies have been changing, so to get back to on that. But most of the community centers are open to the general public, but just have a price difference for resident and non-resident.
Which we do as well.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
Belmarine Keys is an odd example too, though, because they're a hybrid. It is a CSD because they have a few latent powers having to deal with like the keys and dredging and things, but they're also an HOA. And I think the COD kind of works the HOA side of this a lot as well, but that's not the case here. So to your point, just making sure we're comparing apples to apples is, looking at public buildings.
Yep.
Not like we're not even comparing what the Lucas Valley HOA
no,
Community
no,
Center is, because it's a totally different conversation. They're just not bound to the same things that we are bound to as a public agency.
Thank you.
Yes.
Questions?
And you've been waiting.
No, I think I'm sort of neutral on the policy. I think the financials are interesting. I'm not sure for me they'll be the final piece that helps make the decision, but there's been a lot of really interesting questions asked today, and so I think for me it's just sitting with it a little bit in terms of coming to a decision, right?
Is that your intent to come here looking for approval?
I think our intent is that this is a challenging issue, and I think that the building rentals and coming into this position, a year ago, year and a half ago, seeing it with a different perspective and saying, okay, well, what are we doing here, and then being faced with some of the challenges inherent in having this be a part of our programming. Has brought up a lot of questions and a lot of, so looking for direction, I guess, in terms of once we as a staff know, from the commission, from the board, this is what we'd like to see with Marin Woods' private rental policy in terms of, who are we renting to and what our philosophy is on use of the community center by the community or people not within the community. That will help us as a staff create the agreement and the rules and plan staffing and training and how we approach that to be able to do our best job. Right now, it seems like things have just been going on inertia for a very, very long time, and this whole policy and this question has not been addressed as far as I can tell since I've been here. So just looking for direction and from above to say, this is what we want to see from our community center. That'll help us go, okay, now we can take that and know how to approach it from a staffing level.
Well, I think direction and just thought-provoking discussion. These have been good questions. This has been a good conversation that allowed us to think and talk about this a little bit deeper.
I think one more thing that's missing is the current policy. The current rental policy would be helpful to have.
In terms of what? The policy in terms of?
The current rental policy that we have, it would be good to have included in this package.
You mean the actual rental application and what the rules and regulations are? Yeah, we can definitely include that. I feel like, absolutely, that is something that I think is subject to change based on if we make any overarching changes to our...
My reasoning for it is if we decide to go the route where the community center will remain open for rental to general public, then we can either go this drastic way and say no non-residents, or we could make a number of specific policy changes to the rental policy. I mean I'm sure that the no guns is specified there already.
That's just the law, but
various other measures that could be put. And just a suggestion that, it could be an option.
Yeah, absolutely. We definitely include that. Our perspective on that was just that one sort of follows the other. We will be definitely wanting to make changes to the rental policy based on sort of what the feedback is from...
Let's not confuse terms. We don't have a rental policy. We have, rules and procedures of renting the building, which is, in my opinion, a different thing. We don't have an overarching policy that says,
you know, the goal of renting the facility is, or, you know, the objectives, or why we're doing it, or any of that. That just doesn't exist.
No, there are rules.
And we had talked actually about including that, and just kind of felt for this kind of broader conversation that that was getting pretty deep into the weeds, and obviously that was going to be subject to change based on some of this broader discussion and feedback. I'm happy to send it out where it stands right now, so everybody kind of look at it. Obviously, it was on the website for a long time, and we took it down basically because we're not taking in application for the building at this point, again, except for these ones that are kind of these regular, recurring events and rentals that we do every year or every quarter or whatever the case may be. But a lot of that would be subject to change, and then, you know, it's just kind of the rule, you know, must vacate premise by X time. That's, you know, a lot of it's just what you'd expect, kind of standard boilerplate language, but we can easily, you know, it out so everybody can look at it too.
And Luke, I would also like to see the impact, or your opinions of the impact it has on your staff, whether you're now spending more time dealing with issues that come up, or training, or
psychotherapy.
Right. I mean, is, you know, is it a negative impact? Is it just, you know, if you didn't have to do this, what would that allow you time to do? Or so, you know, because it seems like it is a strain on staff, just in the impressions that I get.
Absolutely, definitely could go into that a little bit more detail. Just to answer that real briefly, it's getting challenging, the nature of some of the events. It's a challenging thing for some of our current staff to enforce some of these policies, depending on the group that's here. We have always relied on staff that are already part of our program to be our facility attendant. We have not hired outside people specifically for that job historically, and that's one because they're in our office, they're in our, you know, there's something we have a close relationship with, and people in our programs are hard and vetted through working with us in other capacities, and that's worked out very well. However, so the way things are going, we would have been better served in some of the events that have happened in the last couple of years with a more security guard-esque type of staff member, which we just don't currently have in our, you know, on the roles. And so probably keeping the policy, keeping the way that we're renting the building would, I think, necessitate a change in how we staff the our facility attendants. I'm pretty sure.
I can totally picture Carolyn wearing full armor.
I would never let Carolyn be a facility attendant. and I'm serious, that's actually something I'm very strategic with who I will allow or who I will schedule for those events, because there is an intimidation factor. You've got, you know, 100 plus people here with whatever program. There's only certain individuals I think would be able to, you know, to handle that. And
it's an issue.
I'm not aware
of having additional security staff on site in Marin. I don't think that's the community here.
And that's why I bring it up. If the commission said, you know, or to say, no, we really need to keep the community open, the community center open to the general public, and we shouldn't be limiting to residents, absolutely would have no issue with that moving forward. We would just definitely need to be making some changes to how we approach the rentals. This particular, you know, just is like, this is one way that I think we could keep things a little bit the way we have been running them historically, would be to sort of make this change. But yeah, there might be security guards on the premises. Armed security on the weekends is one thing that we would likely see moving forward with if we keep things status quo.
And I agree with Dan, if that's not the look I want to see, but it's almost like if your party checks this box or checks this box or checks this box, then yeah, you need these things there, and maybe we can just amend it that, you know, we don't have events that are over this size, or we don't have events that serve alcohol, or we don't have events that, you know, you if you want to do these things, find somewhere else to go. But
well,
if you meet the parameters of our guidelines, then you're welcome to come in and have a good time.
I got a couple other comments. John, you were talking about like straining resources. So is it straining resources? Because it's what you said was that this was three events over the course of 150. So that doesn't sound significant to me, but then you just said it is straining our staff resources.
Oh, in terms of, so I guess we need to differentiate between when we've had law enforcement come out because of a physical altercation or a crime being committed or something, right, versus an unruly crowd that's making it very challenging for the building attendant to get the rules to be followed, to get the rental cleaned up and out on time, you know, without incident like that. Those are all challenges, but one is involving, you know, a much bigger, we've got police here. One is that our building facility attendant is having a fairly challenging time, you know, getting through the night and getting the renters to get out on time.
That's the exception. I just want to make sure I understand. That is the exception.
Which is the exception?
One of your staff having a hard time getting through the night. It's happened three times this past year.
No, I say the three times is we've had the law enforcement on the premises because of some major incident.
Okay, so more than that, it's been just more ongoing issue.
Absolutely, just the okay, so and when I say I...
That wasn't clear to me.
Oh, I'm sorry, yeah. So those are two separate things. One being the rentals are challenging for a staff member to just regulate.
So how often is it just a challenge?
That's hard to measure. I think there's challenge inherent in the nature of events anyway. Just big crowds in the building, and just trying to get people to follow the rules and stop the event on time and keep the windows closed and keep the volume down and all that. It's a constant challenge. It's just in the nature of having events. I think that's not unique to us. It just that is with it. So the amount of times I get a phone call, hey, we're having an issue, you know, that one I'd have to really think about how many times I'm really having to help assist the facilities I need to get through and giving them alternatives.
Is it definitely more for non-residents?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just obviously
absolutely
to the scale of the issue.
And so absolutely is the answer to the, it's definitely more
it's,
than non-residents.
It's, without a doubt, the rentals that are taking place rented by Marinwood residents are run very smoothly without issue. That's the overwhelming majority. The rentals that pose challenges for staff to get through the night, get the rules followed, have the building cleaned up, everyone out on time. More often than not, it's a rental taking place from a non-resident. That's not to say all the non-resident rentals are challenging or are bad, and not all the resident rentals are perfect and go without a hitch at all. These are just general, generalities.
Yeah, I would just like...
And I don't have hard data.
No,
not
right,
this number versus
right,
this number.
But it does make it difficult for me to assess the issue when it's that's not really clear.
Absolutely, yeah, no, I understand that.
Sorry, I had a couple of things.
Before we move on,
yeah.
can I make one point, because it's right on topic, which is,
yep,
I think we should consider, though, whether we have to staff to the percentage of events that do create a risk for the community, or whether we staff to the average, right? So say we say it's three events a year where there's crimes, there's violence, right? So do we have to set up our staffing and our policy to manage to that level? Because you don't know which event's going to turn, right?
Right.
Or say 20% of the events are hard to manage. But don't you have to have adequate staff on site then for every event?
Absolutely.
So it's almost like whether it's 10% of events that are affected or 30% of events are affected, I think you still have to staff to the more difficult
scenario.
You're
training.
Right?
And the staff, it's the assumption is that there's going to be a major issue or an emergency. That is what we assume, and that's the training that we go through with staff and the protocols and what they're, you know, watching out for is the worst case scenario, and that's very rare that they end up having to deal with that. But that's what we're planning on, so we're not caught off guard when something happens like that.
So anyway, I just wanted to add that to the discussion. Thanks for letting me jump in.
So Marin County Parks, we allow like filming and other things happen in our preserves, but we we condition the hell out of them, where it's like, if you want to do it, you got to jump through all these hoops, and inevitably a lot of permits don't go through because people don't want to go through all those conditions to do that event. Not to say that we want to create that atmosphere here, but I mean, I think it's a fair question, like, do we want to have big blow-up parties here? Like, maybe we don't. Like, maybe that's not who we are. And then finally, like, yeah, let's say it, like, it feels a little like a gated community. Like, I didn't move here, live in a gated community, and like the idea of like not allowing people to come in from other communities, it doesn't feel good to me. So I definitely want to hear more details, but like, I think if you could be a little more clear with some of the information, it would be helpful for me to try and make a more informed decision.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And just for me to make sure I'm hitting those points with future information provided, could you give me some of the bullet points of like, I mean, one is obviously the financial impact on the, you know, overall budget, proposed changes, what would they likely, how would they likely affect our, you know, revenue, etc. But what some of the other things that you specifically like to see, John?
Well, so definitely dollar amounts, like what are other CSDs or, you know, similar community centers doing? And then, you know, who's impacted by this? How often is it a problem? Like, do we, you know, these are all questions already asked, but it's, I don't have a sense whether or not if we create a residence-only community center, like, do all the problems disappear? Like, I don't have a sense of that.
Is it legal?
That's a good one right there.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, these are all things I could definitely hone in on and give. You know, I can't get exact numbers for everything, but definitely give you a little more of a clear picture. As far as the gated community, I completely understand where that's coming from, and I'm not trying to push this so hard. It's just one option we came up with that would probably be the easiest thing without having to take a bunch of other measures and without having to really limit what opportunities the residents have for rentals, which we typically don't have incident with. So it's just like, what are we going to impose, and how's that going to affect the residents? Is this something that we're trying to really play around with? We don't really want to, you know, impose a bunch of measures that maybe weren't the fault of the resident rentals, which I already, you know, talked about here. But as far as the gated community, one thing is, yeah, we're open to the public. Our programs are open to the public. The park is open to the public. Our events are open to the public. This is like people inside our community center using the kitchen, the tables, the chairs, the floors, and that to me is a little. It's different, and I.
But if every other community center in Marin is allowing the general public to use their space, how are they doing it?
In terms of what, like how are
like,
they?
Like I can go rent a space in Fairfax. I don't live in Fairfax.
Absolutely, yeah.
So how is everybody else making it work? And like, why would we be the exception where we can't allow anybody else in?
Oh, it's not that we can't. It's just that that may be a move that would allow us to move forward with rentals without making major changes to what we allow residents to do in the building.
So,
I mean, I think you understand what I'm saying, though.
Like, absolutely,
Does Fairfax have cops like at all our events? Like, how do they do it? How do they make it work?
So,
like, otherwise we can make
what's
it
the name of the facility in Fairfax? So maybe.
Well, it's the Fairfax Community Center. I mean, but I think every community has one. And this is not like, like you said, it's not unique to us.
No.
It might be just interesting to look at
Oh, no, and we do, and we have that information, and a lot of these community centers do have armed security at the events that go over 100 people, have alcohol, or honoring an individual under the age of 21 as the primary, you know, honoree of the birthday party, whatever it is. So you're seeing security at other community centers.
So I think, but that's the kind of details, like for me to make an informed decision, I would like to have a better understanding of that. If it means for us to be open to the general public, then pretty much every other community center where it is doing X, Y, and Z, and that's what we would need to do too. That would be helpful to understand that.
Oh, absolutely. We talk about whether we would need to add a full-time staff to match the level of, you know, attention being given to that, you know, by the community centers and other recreation departments. What percentage of their staff are dedicated to rentals facilities. You know, is that something that, yeah, we definitely provide that information, how they're dealing with that on a staffing level and on a, you know, for sure.
But if there was, say there's 30 community centers in Oregon, and we're like one of three that's residents only, that would also be interesting to know. Like, where would we sit in relation to all the other community centers?
Yeah, I mean, we definitely try to get all that information if that's, you know.
I think it's an important decision. I just don't want to be like this minority of, you know, we're in community centers that are just like residents only. But, you
know. Okay, good to know. Yeah.
Anything else?
I think that's it.
So we will put this on you to come back next month and tell them.
No, actually, I was going to say that this has actually been extremely helpful to hear all of your perspectives on it. That's the whole point of bringing this memo forward, was just to, you know, to get the commission away. And so this is actually extremely beneficial to hear, you know, both some of the concerns and some of the opinions. So I just want to thank you guys for, you know, for reading it and giving feedback. So.
Thank you.
Okay, then we'll move on to item number 6, the upcoming commissioner term expirations and appointment opportunities.
John, you can just send me your, I want to reappoint letter via email tomorrow.
I'll just reappoint him right here.
No, this is just a simple reminder. The only reason I put this in here is that in October is typically when I post announcements for the upcoming term. Obviously, since we haven't been fully staffed, we post this announcement more often than only in October, but in accordance with the bylaws, these announcements will go out shortly, and whatever comes back will be presented to the board in November, at which point appointments are made for the following two-year term that takes effect in January. So this is just to know that of who we have right now, John and then Shane Valentine's terms will end at the end, current term will end at the end of this calendar year. And then we also have a open spot that with the same two-year term, and then we have a alternate spot. And I believe if I put it in here correctly, the alternate spot term actually ends at the end of 2020.
So talk to your friends and neighbors.
Always like word of mouth, referrals. That's the best way to do it. That's the best way to get people on the commission, is people you think would bring value to the commission to approach them, ask them for interest. I am certainly willing to meet with anybody at any time to talk more about it, kind of go through things in honesty. What Anna's on the commission in large part, and I've also always said this in working with other boards, is, you know, strong boards are formed because they have strong board members because somebody asked them to join.
And the commission's a fun part.
Usually. So if you have anybody who you think could add value and is willing, by all means, please encourage. They haven't been beating down the doors to join our commission.
It's a shame. Item number 7, the Recreation Park Maintenance Activity Report. Hopefully you've seen that.
I know, I'm sorry I've been talking too much.
Any additional details you want to add to that, Lou?
Just noting, we're in our final three weeks of the pool season, coming up on winding up on October 11th, our last day, and things have been going well. Staffing's been a challenge. I'm still in my lifeguard shirt. I meant to change, but I've been a little late. So I'm really appreciative of the rec staff. All of us have been out there, kind of filling in, kind of keeping things going with not a lot of staff going on. But that's been going fine. And then we've got a couple events coming up, Halloween Harvest Festival, the art show coming up in October, which we're looking forward to and started planning for. Robin has a lot of really fun new ideas for the Halloween festival, so if you guys are able to make it to that, we'll
Pumpkins are coming.
Yeah, right. not a lot of anything new to report, but the parks crew will be out soon. We're doing our annual creek walk, highlighting hazards of damming and flood hazards, and we'll be out there chopping up some trees and kind of clearing things out of the drains and V ditches and things ahead of the rain, which is always fun. So we'll be getting things ready, and we'll have a lot of other projects to get done while the weather's nice. So I don't have any questions. Or
did we backfill Victor's spot?
Still being advertised. So we're got some applications, and you know, we're hoping to get some good candidates in here soon.
Do you have interviews set a date or?
I do not have the interview scheduled yet. We just started receiving a couple resumes and applications have been sent out, and we've got that on the calendar. I think everything's due by October 23rd. It's whatever the Friday, but no, 20th October. So we've got another month, you know, about a month.
Pretty good turnout at the car show.
That's what I heard. Yeah, I wasn't able to make it, but
there was a lot of rides there, a lot of nice rides. That, I'm trying to recall the previous years, I think there's twice the number of cars there were probably 2 years ago.
They'd like to double that again if we'd let them. they've done a good job at putting on this car show and coordinating it with other car shows, and have gotten a lot of really positive feedback about this venue, and maybe even approached us about, hey, could we use the other lawn too, and everything else.
How bad does it damage our lawn?
It's hard to say. The grass at the parking lawn, we wait until they're done with that, until we start like our major turf restoration. I mean, it impacts, but and they, you know, there's some damage to sprinklers sometimes, but
less than 1,000 kids running around on it all summer.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, there's not a lot more damage that can occur at that point of the year than after summer.
No, they're good at coordinating with us way in advance, and you know, it's definitely hasn't been a problem.
Yeah, it was seen by a very popular event. Mm-hmm.
They're a good group. The Lions are. Right? Yeah, I'm sure. Very good group of people. They do neat things.
I think that leaves us for future agenda items. Waiting for some more details from you, Luke.
Absolutely.
Anything else that, John?
Okay. How about the continuation of our, we're not doing walkthroughs, we're doing the presentations, so what would be the next
Right,
area of interest, and when would that happen?
Oh, I think we were going to, the next item we were, or the location we were going to look at would be the park itself, I think. But do we want to try to?
We had talked about that being during winter months. So I don't know about by the next meeting, the October meeting, but give us some time to A, work on this, B, shut down the pool, do some other things, and get through some of these other milestones before.
So we'll
talk too much more, but yeah.
So we'll.
There's no December meeting, so if it's not November, it'd be January.
Okay. Anything else? So I ask for a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? Thank you all.
Thank you for the good discussion. It's always invigorating to be able to engage the civil discourse that happens at a higher intellectual level. Thank you.
Thanks for the candy.
Yeah.
Whatever it takes.
Oh, well, in that case, I have a good